the Sermon on the Mount, the purpose, again, is to address the motives, the attitudes, the conditions of our heart. Here in Matthew 7, in the beginning, we're confronted with why we judge. What is our motives that we employ when we bring judgment into other people's lives? You know, remember how Christ begins this sermon in the first few verses of Matthew 5. He says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." And we rehearsed this a number of times over the last few weeks. But what was Christ after? He's saying if we're going to have God's blessing in our lives, if we're going to have his happiness, that's really the idea behind blessing, we begin by understanding our impoverished condition without him and realizing that with him we're everything, without him we're nothing.
Abounding in Faith is the broadcast ministry of Emmanuel Bible Church of Howell, New Jersey. If you are blessed by this message, please subscribe to our podcast or YouTube channel. You can also download our app by searching for IBCNJ in the Google Play Store or the Apple Store. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org. Our speaker today is Senior Pastor Joe Suozzo.
Matthew chapter 7, we're continuing in a series in the Sermon on the Mount. And as we have been discussing, now we're several weeks in, we've been discussing that what Christ is after here is the transformation of our hearts. The transformation of our hearts, that a true, authentic relationship with God is going to be reflected in the attitudes and the behavior of our lives. A true believer is not one in name only, but one who reflects that with the disposition that's in their hearts towards God, and as we're going to see this morning, especially towards others. We read in Matthew chapter 7, I call this the impossible command. Judge not, that you may not be judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it'll be measured to you. Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, "Let me take the speck out of your eye," when there is a log in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Do not give dogs what is holy. Do not throw your pearls before pigs, lest they trample them underfoot and turn to attack you. Father, we pray as we go through this text this morning that we'd find application for our hearts, that we may be the kind of people you've called us to be. We're asking for that, Lord, through the agency and the power of your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. A couple things in this text this morning. I just want to point out the obvious. The first is the command from Christ to judge not. And why I call that an impossible command, because what Christ is after is not so much the way we discern and the way we see others in terms of appropriating judgment, it's the motive behind why we judge. So we're going to look at that this morning. The second thing you see in its text is that before we pronounce judgment, we're always to remember that whatever measure we use, it would come back to us. It would be measured to us. So that's also in the text. Another aspect of this text we see this morning is, how do we then go to a brother or a sister in Christ or someone that we know, we care for? How do we then approach them and take what we see as an error or a problem in their life out of their eye? Well, our starting point is ourselves. We first do a self-assessment, look at the log in our own eye. And so Christ is implicit on that. He's saying here that you will not be able to do this work, this ministry of coming alongside others to help them in their error. And you're not going to do it clearly unless you begin with yourself and make a right judgment upon yourself first. So that's the third thing. And then this final interesting verse of not casting our pearls before swine. This is always a puzzling verse to many people. What Christ, the focus here is not on, which is interesting, is not on the party, it's not on the pig and the dog. That's not the point of that passage. The point of the passage is on the one who's casting. And so how you cast, or how you go about this ministry, which we're all called to come alongside each other and help each other to grow in Christ, is essential. When we do it in an inappropriate manner, it's as though we would be throwing it and wasting it away, because it's going to bring judgment on ourselves. So that's really the essence here. Now, this impossible task to not judge. Now, we're honest with ourselves. Our criticisms, our judgments of others are so habitual and so central to who we are, the way we look at the world, it's almost an impossibility to turn it off. There has to be an inner transformation through the power of God's Holy Spirit. Maybe you heard that old quip. This one guy said, so many people are so judgmental these days. I can tell just by looking at them. We just can't get that out of our minds. We just are in the habit of judging others. Now, what is driving Christ to tell us, to give us this command? Is he giving us something beyond the realm of possibilities? Or is he trying to address something deeper within us? And remember, this sermon, chapters 5 all the way through 7, the Sermon on the Mount, the purpose, again, is to address the motives, the attitudes, the conditions of our heart. Here in Matthew 7, in the beginning, we're confronted with why we judge. What is our motives that we employ when we bring judgment into other people's lives? You know, remember how Christ begins this sermon in the first few verses of Matthew 5. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit. And we rehearsed this a number of times over the last few weeks. But what was Christ after? He's saying, if we're going to have God's blessing in our lives, if we're going to have his happiness, that's really the idea behind blessing, we begin by understanding our impoverished condition without him and realizing that with him we're everything, without him we're nothing. That has got to be the starting point of any of us as we approach the living God. If we somehow think we're self-sufficient ourselves, which was the era, remember, of the Pharisees and the religious establishment, that somehow they were glorying, they were taking confidence in themselves, instead of God's favor, instead of his blessing, instead of his happiness on their lives, they would be filled with judgment and a critical spirit of the world around them. And it would choke off literally, the blessings and the favor of God. There's no quicker way for us to choke off the Spirit of God than to become a cynical, critical person at the world around us. You know what 1 Corinthians 13 says? Love hopes all things. Love hopes all things. He's defining what love is. In other words, when I look at a person, is my first reaction judgment, or am I praying and saying, what is the great potential that God has in that person? I could imagine when I was first showing up, before I actually knew Christ, I was such a lost puppy, that's what I call it, that there would be 101 reasons that someone can levy judgment on me. I was irresponsible, I was proud, I was arrogant, so many ideas that were going in my head that were misplaced and wrong. And so I was worthy of all those judgments, but someone along the line said, you know what? In Christ, I see some potential in that person. Someone prayed and presented to me the gospel of God, the good news of Jesus Christ. And when I received that good news, and believed on him, a process began where inner transformation began in my life, so that I went from a place of selfishness to that wanting to bless the world in Jesus' name. There's no way you can accomplish that without God's power. That is the power of God unto righteousness. You see what the scripture teaches. And so we have to begin by assessing how we see the world around us. And Christ is addressing that. Another beatitude we looked at was Matthew 5:7. What did he say? Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they'll be shown mercy. Here again, Jesus is reaching into our inner hearts and really condemning those without mercy. That was the problem of the culture of that time and this time. Our relationship with God begins with humility and a recognition that we're impoverished without him, but it also begins to realize that without God's mercy, we all stand judged before him. There's none of us who get a pass. All of us are sinners. All of us fall short of the glory of God. We look at ourselves, if you don't see the plank in your own eye, there's no way that you can then take on the ministry of trying to remove. And really, the actual literal word in the Greek text for speck is sawdust. Have you ever compared a piece of sawdust to a log or a plank of wood? There's no comparison. So Jesus is basically saying, look at the plank in your eye. Take that out before you could even go and do it in a clear-minded manner. So this morning we're just going to look at two basic truths or principles from our text. Try to simplify it. First, what is Jesus teaching us here from our text when he tells us to judge not? What does he really mean here? What is he trying to bore into? And then we're going to look at his invitation to extend mercy. Because remember, the idea here is he's not telling us to go and stop trying to remove the speck, but there's a process, because we all need it. There are many times I've had brothers and sisters in Christ saying, Pastor Joe, you need to address this issue or that issue. Thank you. I hope that you're in a posture this morning of allowing someone to take the speck out of your own eye. But if someone's doing it, my prayer is they start with the log. So let's look at these truths. Our reasons for being critical. I've got three of them. There are probably others, but I just thought of these three. Why do we levy inappropriate judgments on others? Well, first, it's what I call misplaced God-given conscience. Now, every one of us have been given a God-given conscience to discern good from evil. Every one of us has a conscience here to know what's right from wrong. We're created in God's image, and one of God's qualities is judgment or a sense of right and wrong. And so when we take on that quality, it is a partially God-given quality when we bring judgment on the world around us. But because of sin, and this is key here, because we have fallen short of the glory of God, sin, this God-given conscience, has been twisted and darkened. And so rather than judging rightly based on God's standard and looking at ourselves because of sin in a fallen world, many of our judgments are misplaced and run afoul of what is true. Now, the Apostle Paul brings attention to this in Romans chapter 2. Now, there's all kinds of problems in the Roman church. Judging one another was one of them. And he says this, you who pass judgment are without excuse. Why? Because you passing judgment on someone else, you're doing the same thing. Oh, isn't that so true? How often that we levy judgment and we could never stand up to the judgment we're executing. We see examples of this all around us, all around us. The other day I was reading a news article about two congresswomen who had a rather spicy exchange. I just go through a news feed every day, and this particular exchange just said, wow, this is exactly what I'm preaching on. There was one representative who insulted the other representative by telling her she had fake eyelashes that were getting in the way. This is in the Hall of Congress. And the other one immediately demanded that her comments be removed from the record. And so there's a spicy exchange. All the news outlets, maybe you saw the feed, all the news outlets, because look, let's face it, the media loves this kind of stuff. It sells news, you know. You want to read, like, what goes on here, you know? And after she states and a number of other Congress people were saying, things should not be done like this, strike it from the record. 2 days later, the congresswoman who was complaining about the other, who said that she had fake eyelashes, she writes in the social media swag that this woman had bleached blonde, she was bleached blonde with a badly built butch body. Right? So then Jake Tapper from CNN News is interviewing her, and he asked her, how could she post such a thing after she made the complaint in the Congress hall of to remove the record? And so really what the newscaster was saying, look, you're levying this judgment against this woman, then you go and do the same thing. And so she lost total credibility. And we live in a world like that because people are not assessing and bringing judgment with right judgment. Now, going back to Matthew 7:1, Jesus addresses it this way. Judge not, or you will be judged. In the same way you judge, it will be measured to you. Because our hearts are corrupted, because our God-given conscience is twisted by sin, instead of extending right judgment, we tend to implode wrong judgment on people, and as a result, we ourselves are the one who stands condemned because of our judgments. And so God's desire here is that we be transformed to not do it that way. The second reason that we often judge wrongly is pride and self-sufficiency. "Yeah, that's really bad, Dad." I said, "Look a little bit closer. Look closer. You know anything?" And finally the light bulb clicked on, you see. Quick to judge the mess of another person's house, not so quick to begin with themselves, you see. We all do it, you see. It's just more exaggerated with teenage kids. We do this because we want to feel safe about ourselves. We want to feel sufficient about ourselves. Jesus tells us, listen to how Jesus says it here in Matthew 7, verse 4. "How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your own eye,' when all the time there's a plank in yours?" That's the heart of our issue, our lack of meekness and humility about ourselves. If I'm levying judgment on the world around us, and I have not mercy in my heart and a sense of love, compassion, all this is saying is I'm proud and arrogant in who I am aside from God. Listen to the way the Apostle Paul frames this out. I love this verse. This is from 2 Corinthians 10:12. He says, "Those who compare themselves with themselves and measure themselves by themselves are without understanding." You see, if we begin to mete out judgments upon the world around us, really what Scripture is saying, it's a lack of wisdom, a lack of understanding, because we haven't begun with ourselves. And we all struggle. We understand that if the only way we can overcome this, we begin that we all fall short of God's glory. We all struggle with weakness. We all struggle. That's the whole point. And Christ becomes our sufficiency, not ourselves. Third reason, final reason, personality and cultural differences. Personality and cultural differences. We all come from a variety of backgrounds. Some of these are racial, some of these are cultural, some of these have personality aspects to them. For example, let's talk about personality. Some are quieter than others, others are more talkative. One person tends to be kinder and gentler and more in tune with other people's feelings, while another person is more task-oriented, serious about getting the job done, and comes across more sharp-edged. All these differences, by the way, are God-given differences. When do they become a source of conflict? They become a source of conflict when we don't allow God to control us and to use us as he deems fit. So if I begin to see another person's differences as a problem rather than a blessing, before you know it, the world of judgment is going to begin to destroy, whether it be within the family, the church, the business, wherever the community may be. I worked on a missions team when we were in India for a number of years, and my wife and I were the only people from the Northeast. Everything else was from Kansas and the South. And there was a funny thing. We finally came to a conclusion in some of the conflict we had as a team. They said, "When Joe's talking, we think he's angry and confronting us. And when we're confronting him, he thinks we're talking." Now, if you worked with anybody from the Midwest, they're very slow to confront and say anything. But here in the Northeast, we're very direct. We're very quick to get to the heart of the issue. That's a cultural difference. That's not a difference from, that's a sin issue. That's just a cultural difference. Churches, for example, in Galatia, Rome, Colossae, if you read these epistles that Paul wrote, they're constantly being divided by cultural differences between Jew and Greek, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free. There are class distinctions, racial distinctions, religious distinctions. I love what Paul says, 1 Corinthians 9. Listen to how he resolves it. "To the Jew, I became like a Jew, to win Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law. To the weak, I became weak. To the win the weak, I have become all things to all men, so that all possible means I might save some. I do this all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in his blessing. What is he saying here? He's saying that when he does render judgment and he's going out into the world, whether it be Jew, Greek, or whoever, the primary thing is he sees himself as a vessel of God's blessing to bless others. So God is not saying don't try to take the speck out of someone's eye, but you start with the plank in your own. Because if you try to take that speck out and you levy judgment on another person or another group, what winds up happening is your vision of what's going on is blurred instead of being cleared. And you know, our culture today, if you haven't noticed, our culture is a whirlwind of judgment. They call it an age of tribalism. You have black, white, Latino, you have rich, poor. You see, hear, listen to the politicians are constantly levying one group against another, and people begin to identify themselves in a particular group instead of going back to the fact that we all came from Adam and Eve, every one of us. No matter what your position, we're all men, and we all stand before God. And if you don't start there, and you start to identify yourself through culture, personality, or whatever, what winds up happening instead of God's blessing and favor, we wind up in a whirlwind of judgment. And with the same measure we use, it gets measured to us. Colossians 3:11, in Christ, listen to this, in Christ, no difference. There's no Jew, no Gentile, no barbarian, no Scythian, no slave, no free. Christ is all and in all. Isn't that a wonderful message? And then when you get to the book of Revelation, at that some of those final pictures of heaven, you stand there and look at that picture, you see people from every language, every tongue, every tribe worshiping God in Christ. And they all are clothed in the same way with the white linens through the shed blood of Christ. If we don't start there and end there, we're not going to have hearts of mercy to the world around us. And so Jesus invites us. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you'll see clearly how to remove the speck from your brother's eye. So Christ gets to the heart of the issue. Now, let's look at this thing positively. What are some of the reasons God calls us to extend mercy, encouragement, or even correction to those we love around us? The first starting point for any of us, if we're going to help somebody else, is we begin to understand that we ourselves have received mercy. We give mercy, or we reach into other people's lives because we have received mercy. We don't go into another person's life to say, let me straighten out the mess of that human being that is there, before we recognize that we ourselves are a mess of a human being. And one of the reasons Jesus put his finger on this is because they lived in a whirlwind of judgment and hypocrisy amongst the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. They had a standard amongst themselves which focused on their outer religious observances. That's one of the things that Christ is addressing here in the Sermon on the Mount. Yet they themselves had sinful attitudes that were resident in their own hearts. They struggled with their own sin, and yet they were quick to judge others. Earlier on, for example, in Matthew 5, 21, 22, he says this. He's really talking to religious establishment. You agree that the law is good, he says. You heard that it said long ago, do not murder. So there is no debate on that. We don't have any debate on that in our culture about murder. We all know it's wrong. But then he says this, I tell you the truth, anyone who's angry with his brother has committed murder in his heart. Whoa, Christ is raising a whole new standard now. Do you mean that if I remain angry with another person, especially a brother in Christ or a family member, if I let bitterness fester in my heart, it is the exact same sin as murder? Why? Because the same sin that leads to murder, which of course is the worst of all possibilities, is the same sin that makes me angry with my brother. And so Christ goes through all of these various sins. He talks about adultery and lust. He talks about unforgiveness and bitterness. I tell you, anyone who's angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. He talks about giving, fasting, prayer. So many areas are addressed in this sermon. Matthew, the writer of this gospel, the apostle God inspired here, he brings this hypocrisy to light in many other chapters. One of my favorite chapters in the Gospel of Matthew is in 9, because he gives his own personal testimony of how he got out of a corrupt business of tax collecting and began to follow Christ. It's an interesting text. I encourage you to read it in its entirety, and let me explain it to you. Jesus calls Matthew to leave his tax booth and come follow him. Matthew leaves his tax booth and begins to follow, and he immediately invites Christ to a lunch. Come to my house, have lunch. He doesn't just invite Jesus, but he invites other sinners like himself, people who are also struggling. But then at that lunch were also Pharisees and teachers of the law. These priests see what's going on. They ask the other disciples, they say, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? Because you see, in their mind of judgment, they said, if you're going to eat with tax collectors and sinners, that disqualifies you. That makes you a greater sinner than they are. Hearing this, listen to what Jesus said. It is not the healthy who needs a doctor, but the sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I come to call the righteous, not sinners, but sinners. And Jesus, quoting here from the prophet Hosea, was condemning Israel for their religiosity, but not extending mercy to the world around them. And so, if we're going to help others, we begin by recognizing that we ourselves have received mercy, that we ourselves have been forgiven, and that's the beauty of the gospel. The gospel is this: we as sinners have been forgiven through the shed blood of Christ. We begin to stand before God, not in our own righteousness, but in the righteousness of Christ based on what he has done for us. It's not by works that we're saved, but through faith, through grace. This is our beginning start. If we remember that at all times and say, wow, God has taken the log and he's forgiven me for it, then I remember that before I go into other people's lives. So that's, we got to begin there. Another reason for extending mercy: we cannot bear God's judgment. We cannot bear God's judgment. Here's the bottom line: we cannot stand up to the judgment of God. None of us can. It's only through Christ we're forgiven. We're only through Christ we're made clean. And when we realize that, now we can extend mercy, has been extended to us. This is a constant humbling ourselves before God. I love 1 John 4. He says, God sent his son into this world that we may live through him. It's not we who love God first, but he loved us and sent his son as a propitiation for our sins, or a sacrifice for our sins. If we don't see our sin and God's mercy, it is an impossibility to go about the world and be a force for good. Instead, we're going to measure out wrong judgment instead of right judgment. Instead of criticizing others, we're called to be patient. Instead of judgment, we're called to love. Instead of looking down on others, we see ourselves for who we really are. It's such a liberating way to live, by the way. To give pause when I'm criticizing someone, and I say, wait a minute, who am I to bring judgment on another person? But then I go back to the gospel. I say, wow, God, you've done all this in my life. Maybe you can do that in that person's weakness too. And then I go with great humility instead of pride. Just one other area before we finish up. We're called to be salt and light. If you go back to the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 5, Jesus says we're light of the world. We're salt. Now, light and salt change whatever it touches. Dark room, you turn on a light, you see what's in it. Salt, you put it on food, it changes it. Changes its properties. It's able to preserve things, salt. We're called to be salt and light into the world around us. So really, Christ is not telling us to stop trying to take the speck out of our brother's eye. But he's trying to help us to enter into any ministry that we endeavor to help people to begin with ourselves before we can help others. We have to begin by remembering who we really are. Their speck, like a piece of sawdust. My sin, like a plank. It really helps. It's such a simple teaching. It really helps to release judgment. We're in a crazy political year, right? So much toxicity in the news. I hope you're praying and asking God to bring healing and revival in this nation. Memorial Day, right? We're going to gather tonight. I encourage you to come at 6 o'clock. What do? One of the things we do is we pray for this nation. If you think that a politician's going to straighten out the mess that we're in, you're sorely mistaken. I'm not saying policies don't matter at all. I'm just saying that the ultimate touch this nation needs is the power of God. And certainly when you listen to these newscasters and politicians, it's a whirlwind of judgment. And if you don't feel bad listening to it, then you must be an Autobahn, because no matter how you listen to it, you're going to walk away angry, frustrated, and disillusioned. But think about the freedom that comes when we see the world the way Christ is calling us. If I see the world as a world of possibilities, where God can enter into another person's life, bring transformation and change and goodness and light and love, I become a positive person instead of cynical and dark. You want to become a darkened, cynical individual? Just keep on listening to that talk radio and talk commentary news. You just bathe yourself with that and read a couple verses a day, and you'll be an angry, soured individual. The only way you're going to get past that is saturate yourself with the love of God through his word. 1 Corinthians 13:5. Love hopes all things. Love is patient and kind. I see others' faults, patient. You know, in every single one of Paul's letters, he has 13 letters, the Apostle Paul. How does he begin his letters? Grace and peace to you from God our Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why does he begin every single letter that way? Because the church of God, without grace and peace, cannot stay together. Grace is my ability to see you and for you to see me and say, despite all the mess I see in your life and despite the mess that I see in your life, I think I got lost in that sentence. See, that's just another mess you can extend grace to. I extend grace just as God has extended grace to me. I love just as God has loved me. And grace and peace is not inner peace he's talking about there. He's talking about peace amongst the brother. And some of us have been through churches where people shredded themselves instead of offering forgiveness and grace. It's so easy to do, isn't it? So easy to do. Colossians chapter 3, Paul encourages us this way. Put on compassionate hearts. That's love. Put on humility. Put on patience. Put on meekness. Bearing up with one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, let him forgive as the Lord has forgiven him. Let him also forgive. It's obvious that our ability to discern and judge is needed when we enter other people's lives. However, our judgment is wrong if it's for the wrong reason. But if we enter into people's lives with a desire to love, build up, encourage, give a word to affirm instead of tearing down, it changes everything, doesn't it? You know, there's an interesting story. You know, and churches, by the way, fail at this all the time. That's why we need to hear this sermon. But there's an interesting story of when the British and French were fighting in Canada. This is back in the 1750s, there was an Admiral Phipps, was his name. He was the commander of the British fleet. He was told to anchor outside Quebec. And he was given orders to wait for the British forces to land, then support them when they attacked the city. He arrived early. As the Admiral waited, 1 week went into two, he became annoyed by the statues of the saints that adorned the towers of a nearby cathedral. And so he commanded his men to shoot at them with the ship's cannons. No one knows how many rounds were fired or how many statues were knocked out, but when the forces finally landed and he was given the signal to attack, the Admiral was no help. He had used up all his ammunition shooting at the saints. Isn't that the worst picture you can think of in a church? Do you realize we have such an amazing opportunity when you get up and you leave, you can go up to someone that you don't know, listen to their story, and give a word of love, a word of affirmation, a kindness? Do we need that? Do we need more judgment amongst ourselves? Absolutely not. That is the way the believer's life can have such a transforming ability in other people's lives. Instead of redemption and building up, if we criticize, it'll be tearing down. Instead of wars, there'll be kindness, gossip. Instead of gossip and pettiness, beauty and love. And so Jesus tells us, do not judge for the same measure you use, it'll be measured you. And I'm gonna just quickly cover this last verse. I always was puzzling over this verse of don't give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under feet and then turn and tear you to pieces. I was really praying and meditating on this. I said, you know, in the past I always thought, I just want you to know what I thought, which is ironic. Think about the context now. The irony I thought is I should not share the word of God with those who are like dogs and pigs. Now, does that make sense in the context? No, I see Ray saying no. I began to think about it. It's not focusing on the dogs and the pigs. It's saying that if, this is the way I believe it, because based on the context, you have to interpret scripture based on context. If I go and judge a brother without first looking at the plank in my own eye, and if I go with the wrong reason, and do it without clarity, because I haven't started by the fact that I've received mercy from God. If I begin to bring judgment instead of mercy, then I'm the one who's failing here. I'm the one who's wasting my life. I'm the one who's like throwing words out to pigs and dogs who are not going to appreciate it. It's not about the pigs and the dogs. It's about me and how I go about things. That's kind of the insight the Lord gave me. Very difficult verse. It's hyperbole. Not calling an unbeliever a pig or a dog. That just doesn't make sense, what Christ is saying here. Proverbs 25:1, we're going to finish with this. A word aptly spoken is like settings of gold or silver. We get to leave this place and be a blessing to the world around us, don't we? But we start with ourselves. Allow God to change your heart, to take away all those edges of bitterness and judgment and that critical spirit we all bear, and carry the love of Christ. What a mission, right? But we can't accomplish it unless we start with ourselves. And then you, me, this church, could be such a source of blessing to the world around us. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the word of God, the challenge this morning to not judge with inappropriate measure, to realize with the measure we use, it'll be measured to us, to realize that each of us, because of sin, have a plank in our own eye. Help us before we move to bring correction and reproof and love, you know, whatever we're called to do, Lord, we do it with appropriate measure. Help us not to fail into this task, but you called us out, Lord, to be salt and light. And we pray that that's what we'd be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for listening to the previous message. We pray that you were blessed by it. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org.